petitioning God for. This is the moment, church. The altars are open. Make your way. Don't wait for the person next to you. God is here to meet you, to meet your need, to meet you in your situation. So, Father God, we proclaim, Father God, this evening and this morning, that you fill this room, that you fill us. Holy Spirit of God, have your way. Have your way. Fill this room. We press into more. We want more of you. We don't want business as usual. We want more. We want next level. We want to keep moving forward into what God has for us. What God has for us. Father God, we just thank you for all that you are. For all that you are and all that you're doing in this house. And we just ask, Lord, that you continue to give us the strength to keep pressing in, to keep pressing in. That as we stand as the threshold, the spiritual threshold, that we can step over and keep pushing and not settle and not settle, because we won't settle. Father God, we declare, we say that you send the rain, that you send the rain, and that you allow it to pour out in us, that you allow it to pour out in us. We just thank you, my God, for all that you are.
Good morning, church. As we're here today on this Sunday, let's pray. Let's talk to God. Amen. God, thank you for bringing us here today. Thank you for keeping us safe and being with us throughout this week. And thank you for allowing us to be here in your presence. You work in beautiful and miraculous ways, God. Bring those works in today. As we worship you, let us feel you around us. As we hear your word, let it touch everyone in the way you want it to. And as we continue, we ask you to envelop us in your grace and your mercy. Because without you, we can't do anything. But with you, God, we can do everything. In your mighty name we pray. Amen.
Oh, I pray that you came in this morning with a heart prepared to meet the Lord. You came, your heart's prepared, open to what God is about to do in our lives. Don't ever give up on God, because he is about to do something in this church, in this body, in this world. Today is upside down, but God is still on the throne. Believe that with all your heart and trust him. And in prayer, you're going to see things happen in your life. Pray with a broken heart, because a broken heart is what reaches God. A broken heart is what's going to get you to that place connected to God. And because of a broken heart that you pray with, is that same brokenness that is going to draw God to you, and he's going to see you through whatever circumstance you're going through in your life. Let's pray. Father, we come to you this morning. Lord, we believe in the God of miracles and the God of power and the God of all authorities. Father, we come to you, Father God, with a heart, Lord Jesus, wanting to get closer and closer to you every day, oh God. Father God, draw us closer to you, Father God, because that way, Father God, the sins of our lives, Father God, the things that we're dealing with in our daily lives, Father God, will be broken from us, oh God. Father, because of when we draw closer to you, oh God, you will draw closer to us, Father God. And the sins, Father God, that come so easily in our lives, Father God, because it's all the way around us, Lord. It would be drawn away from us, oh God, and we can get to that place, oh Lord, where we can get closer to you, Father God. And we would learn, Father God, of your ways, Father God. And we would learn, Father God, that through prayer, Father God, we can see the miracles. We can see the things happening in our own lives. Father God, so we pray this morning, we believe, Father God, that we're praying to the God of all miracles. Father God, we worship you, Father God. We come this morning with a heart of worship, Father, to get closer to you, to draw closer to you, because you are the King, you are the Lord, you are the Christ. You paid the price at the cross of Calvary. You shed your blood for us, oh God. This is why we're here in this house today, Father God. We're proclaiming victory, Father God, in this place. Father God, we're believing for a miracles, Father God. Hearts will be touched, Father. Today is the day, Father God, of salvation. Today is the day, Father God, where you will prepare us, oh God, to move forward, Father God. Today is the day of revival. Father God, send the Spirit in this house like never before. Father God, and touch the nations. Touch our city, Father God. Fill this house to capacity, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
on, just worship him this morning. How many of you are so thankful for Jesus this morning? Hallelujah. Oh, we love you. Oh, we're so thankful. We're thankful. We're thankful. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you, Jesus. Oh. Sometimes we just ask for things all the time, but do we ever stop and just let him know how much we love him? Just let him know how much you love him. We know that he loves us. We know. But let us tell him this morning how much we love him. So let's just do that together. Oh, we love you. Oh, we love you. Jesus, oh, we love you. love you and we worship you. Oh, we are for you. We are for you. We stand on your word. We stand on your promise, God. There is none like you. There is none like you. There is none like you. Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we love you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, and I just feel this morning that if you came in here with heaviness, if you came in here with discouragement, I believe God wants to knock that off you this morning. I believe that the Holy Spirit wants to. So listen, if you came in here with a heavy heart or some discouragement, just lift your hands this morning. Come on, I know some. There you go. Praise the Lord. The Holy Spirit is saying that now it is broken off you as you worship, as you worship, as you offer Him a sacrifice of praise. The discouragement and the heaviness will go. And I just believe that in the name of Jesus. God spoke to me this week. He said, do not bow to discouragement. Do not bow to fear. That if you will trust God, He's going to do great and mighty things in our midst. So I declare that this morning for this house. Do not bow to fear. Do not bow to discouragement. We bow to one and one only. And His name is Jesus Christ, the Savior, the one who died on the cross. Oh God, you deserve all the praise. You deserve all the glory this morning. So we declare and decree heaviness, brokenness, it must flee now in the name of Jesus. Come on, lift your hands and receive it this morning. We serve an awesome God. Yes, Jesus. We serve an awesome God. We serve a faithful God. Yes, Lord. You are faithful, Jesus. We can give it all to you, God. You can run our lives way, 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 way better than us, Jesus. Have your way in us. Come on, where's my control freaks in here this morning? The one who thinks they know better than you. This is no perfect people allowed, right? So where's the real people? Where's the people that want to nudge Jesus out of the driver's seat and grab the wheel? He's saying, let me have the wheel and see what happens. Praise the Lord. Oh, Jesus, we love you, Lord. Oh, thank you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus. Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness. You have filled me with peace. Giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help. Let's sing that again. Father of kindness, sing it. Father of kindness, you have poured out grace. You brought me out of darkness. You have filled me with peace. A giver of mercy, you're my help in time of need. Lord, I can't help. Come on, declare it. Faithful.
Faithful you are. All your promises are yes and amen.
Jesus. Oh, Jesus. We believe. Thank you, Jesus. Beautiful Savior. Beautiful Savior, you have brought me near. You pulled me from the ashes. You have broken every curse. Blessed Redeemer, you have set this captive free. Lord, I can't help but say,
come on, faithful. Oh, Jesus, we love you, Lord. We worship you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh. Woo. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. So as we lay it all down, Lord, you want to give us your perfect peace, God. You want to give us your perfect peace, God. We rest in you, Jesus. We rest in you. And I will rest. Come on. In your promises, my confidence is your faithfulness. And I will rest in your promise. My confidence is your faithful. Come on, I will rest.
And I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. And I will rest.
Come on, sing it this morning.
It's your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness.
And all your promises are yes and amen. One more time.
And all your promises are yes and amen.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Oh, Jesus. Oh, God, we love you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, lift your hands in this place. We worship the name of Jesus. We worship you, God. We worship you, Jesus. We need your presence.
Jesus,
change us. Transform us. Have
Jesus,
your way, Jesus. Oh, we love you, Daddy. We worship you. We give you glory and honor. Holy Spirit. Oh, oh, la mama shanda de de ye de. Oh, baba shata de de. Oh, we love you, Jesus.
Yeah. Jesus.
My God, my God, my God, Jesus. Let your presence have its way. Oh, like a mighty wind. Holy Spirit.
Yes and amen.
We love you, Jesus. We love you, Jesus.
Hear the word of the Lord this morning.
The Lord is telling us today to stay focused. That is the word, to stay focused. Focused on Him, because where your mind goes, your body will follow. If your mind is focused on finances, on fears, on troubles, on outside nonsense, on politics, on Facebook, if that's where your mind is, that's where your soul will be. If your mind is focused on Jesus, if it's focused on Jesus, all the other nonsense, all the other noise, all the other will disappear. Stay focused on the Lord. Keep our minds focused. And we get pulled away. Satan pulls us away so easy, so quick, that we don't even know we're being pulled away until we're camping there. Don't camp there. Stay focused on the Lord. The word from the Lord today is stay focused on Him.
Thank you, Jesus. Hold on a second. Isaiah 23 says, you will keep in perfect peace him whose mind is stayed on you. He will keep you in perfect peace if you keep your mind on Him. So that's the word of the Lord this morning. Let's respond. You will keep perfect peace whose mind is stayed on Him. It's always back to the word. Thank you, Jesus. We need your perfect peace, God. Our minds are stayed on you, Lord. We need your perfect peace, God. When our minds are stayed on you, Jesus. Perfect peace, God. When our minds are stayed on you, Jesus. We focus on you, Lord. You give us perfect peace, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Perfect peace, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Our minds are stayed on you, Lord. Our minds are stayed on you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus.
And I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. And I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. And I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness. And I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness, and I will rest in your promises. My confidence is your faithfulness.
Communion. Communion, in the most basic meaning in a Christian worship service, is when bread and juice are declared sacred and shared in remembrance of Jesus. But according to the dictionary, it also means the sharing or exchanging of intimate thoughts and feelings, especially when the exchange is mental or spiritual. When having communion with the Lord, not only are we taking communion in remembrance of Him, but we are exchanging our thoughts and feelings, Him towards us and us towards Him. We know that His will for us is to live in sozo, nothing broken and nothing missing. And nothing means nothing. But I have come to realize that most of the things that we go through in life is a process. They don't get better overnight all the time. Sometimes they take medicine. Sometimes I get in the way. Most of the time, I get in the way. Sometimes I just can't believe Him. The thought of Him doing that thing is too big. Or sometimes I believed Him and it didn't happen. Whatever your process may be, rest assured, He was thinking of you on the cross. Now I want you to close your eyes and think about what it is you have to exchange. Maybe it's praise and thanksgiving, but maybe, just maybe, it's hurt, it's pain, it's sickness, it's doubt or disbelief. Whatever it is between you and Him. Now I want you to envision yourself exchanging what needs to be exchanged. Leave what you need to leave at His feet and receive what He has for you. We'll take a minute for that. First Corinthians warns us not only to examine ourselves, but it says, "For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner, eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." We've just had a time of exchange with the Lord. But before we take the emblems, because this is so sacred, I want everyone to bow their heads. And if you are holding anything against anyone in this room, with heads bowed and eyes closed, I want you to go make it right. We'll take a minute. Text that person. Do whatever it is you have to do to make it right before we take communion. We also do not partake of communion if you are not saved. So if that happens to be you, we're going to take care of that right now. Everyone, we're all going to say this together, okay? Repeat after me. Lord Jesus, I come to you today because I need a Savior. I know I cannot save myself. I open the door of my heart and ask you to come in. Not only do I open the door for you to be my Savior, but I ask you to be my Lord. Thank you for saving me. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. So 1 Corinthians 11:23 through 29 says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, took the bread, Everybody grab your emblems. He took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." So if you need any healing, any type of healing, mind, soul, body, I want you to place your hand on that body part and take the bread and watch it do its work in you. So if you're seated and you need a healing, stand and place your hand on that body part. And let's take the emblem together now. Okay, now let's all stand, please. In this same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. This, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For he who eats and drinks in an unworthy manner eats and drinks judgment to himself, not discerning the Lord's body." We already took care of that, right? Amen. So let's drink the cup. In 1 Corinthians 11, Jesus shows us how to have communion with him. We are acknowledging that his body was broken for us. Why must we remember him? Because it was a sacrifice that he chose to do on the cross. For you and for me, that has paved the way for us today. We remember him with thanksgiving and grateful heart. Remember, his body was broken for you. Now let's praise the Lord for all he has done.
Jesus, worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. Worthy is your name, and worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve the praise. You deserve
I want you to sing it.
Worthy is.
Keep singing.
Jesus, you deserve. Worthy is you. Sing, worthy is your name.
Jesus,
you deserve. Worthy. Sing it again. Worthy is your name, Jesus. You deserve.
Now come on, lift your hands all over this house, even right now. Just begin to magnify his name. Come on out loud. Just begin to magnify his name. Just begin to glorify his name. Come on, just begin to adore the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Come on and lift your voice all over this house. Come on and lift your voice all over this house. We worship you, O God. We give you glory and honor and praise. We magnify you, Jesus. We honor you. We lift you up. We lift you up. We lift you up. All glory and honor and praise belong to you, O God. All glory and honor and praise belong to you, O God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah to the Lamb of God who was and is to come. There is no other. We love you, Lord. We honor you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Be magnified in this place, O God. Be magnified in this place. Hallelujah. Hallelujah to the Lamb. You are good. You are good and your mercy endures forever. Hallelujah. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. You are Almighty God who was and is to come. We worship you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Come on, worship in the Holy Ghost. Come on, I want to hear you this morning. I want to release the gift of God within you. That's it. Come on, lift your voice. Don't be afraid. Lift your voice. Lift your voice. If you're not baptized, be baptized in the Holy Spirit right now. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God. Come on, if you're happy to be in the house of the Lord today, put your hands together and give the Lord some praise. Come on, some of you get more excited over cheesecake. Come on, if you're really happy to be in the presence of the Lord today, give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Very softly. Hallelujah. You may be seated in the wonderful presence of the Lord this morning. Glory to God. Glory to God. Now listen, I don't know about you, but I don't come to church to be mamby-pamby. I don't come to church to be Tickle Me Elmo, Mickey Mouse, Willy Wonka. But we come into the house of the Lord to press, to push. We come into the house of the Lord fully expecting, in great anticipation to meet with the Most High God. And let me tell you something, church, that is no small thing. That is no small thing. Listen, I love you, but I didn't come to see you today. I love the worship team, but I didn't come to see them today. I love my staff, but I didn't come to see them today. Today, I'm totally focused on the Holy Ghost. Today, I'm totally focused on what God wants to do in this house, in you. Hallelujah. And it's about time that we walk in the authority that God has given to us. We're not victims. You got a sad story? I've got a sad story. Let it go. And understand that you walk in authority. You walk in power. Doesn't mean sometimes that our hearts aren't broken or that we're discouraged, because we do. We are sometimes. But we don't live there. We're not victims. We are not victims. Turn to your neighbor and tell him, you're not a victim. Tell him you are a victor You are a victor. You walk in victory. You walk in victory. You walk in victory. We're not waiting for the victory to happen. We walk in victory. You walk in victory. You are victorious. You are more than a conqueror. You are an overcomer. That's right, you are. You are. Oh, but Pastor, you don't know. I don't need to know. You are an overcomer. You're victorious. Listen, I will give you a hug and pat you on the back, but you better walk in victory. You better learn to walk in victory. We come into this house not to be mamby-pamby, wishy-washy, but we come to stand strong, knowing that God is faithful and that He will meet you. He will meet you at your point of need. He will meet you. And so I don't have to worry about all that other stuff. I've come to declare that strongholds are coming down. I've come to declare that the lost are being saved, that the sick are being healed, that the oppressed are being set free, that the blind are receiving their sight, and the deaf are receiving their hearing. Because that's the power that we walk in. That's the power that I walk in. That's the power that you walk in. Somebody say amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. As some of you may know, this week we lost two amazing people. Joe Beltran went home to be with the Lord on Sunday, and Steve Brown went home to be with the Lord on Thursday. Some of you may see that as defeat, because we've been praying and we've been believing God to do a miracle. And I want to let you know that He did do a miracle. He did a miracle. I want you to know that Joe Beltran and Steve Brown are having a service in the heavens today that you can't even begin to imagine. I want you to know that with their last breath on this side of eternity and their first breath in heaven, they came face to face with our Savior. I want you to understand that sometimes God doesn't do things the way we think He should do them. Hello? Hello? I want you to know that God knows what is best. I want you to know that it is appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. Okay, sister, thank you. It is appointed unto man once to die, and then the judgment. We all have an appointment with death, every single one of us. And I know that Joe was ready to meet her Savior. And I know that Steve was ready to meet his Savior. And so this is where the rubber meets the road with our faith. Do we still believe God when things happen the way we don't think they should happen? Oh God, but we prayed and we believed. Maybe we shouldn't pray anymore. No. Our job is to keep praying. We keep believing. And now we rejoice with Joe. We rejoice with Steve. They both fought a precious battle on this side. They fought with everything that they had. They are examples to all of us to fight and to believe. And Joe Beltran was not a pastor. She wasn't an evangelist, an apostle, a teacher. But I remember she stood here and gave us the most powerful message a couple months ago. And she said, people get ready because Jesus is coming soon. Jesus is coming soon. Jesus is coming soon. I'm just a little bit mad at her right now because she beat me to heaven. Steve beat me to heaven. I'll go when he's ready for me. I'm in no rush. You know what I'm saying? Come on. Don't put me in the ground yet. Yeah, we got plenty of work to do, don't we? Hallelujah. We rejoice with them, but we grieve with their families. Because on this side of eternity, listen, on this side of eternity, we hurt. On this side of eternity, we experience grief. On this side of eternity, we cry. So our job now as a church family is to surround Yvonne and her family, to surround Louis Beltran and his family, and to uplift them, to encourage them. So I'm going to ask this body to make phone calls, to send cards. Don't show up at their house just uninvited. Just call them first, okay? Because sometimes they want their privacy, right? This is a tough time. But also, we have two services this week. This Thursday night, from 6 to 8, right here in the sanctuary, we are having a memorial service for Joe Beltran, right here from 6 to 8. On Friday, from 9 in the morning to 11, we're having a service for Steve Brown. Okay? After each service, we're having a repast. A repast is the, you know, the fellowship time, the food time afterwards, just to get together and encourage the family. I'm going to ask this congregation to do everything that we can to provide the food and the help that we need, or money, whatever it is that we need to do, to make sure that we honor these two families, that we bless these two families. And if you're interested in doing that, either with food or money or just being here to help with and anything you can do, I want you to see Dawn Klein after the service. She's going to go ahead and help you. She's putting all of that together. Thank you, Dawn, for putting all of that together. We appreciate that. Well, we want to ask you to continue to pray for Steve Hickman and Debbie Cologne and Devin Peterson. And also, just a reminder to pray for Nicole de Jesus. Some of you may not know, but she lost her grandparents and her aunt all within about a week's time. They all live in Florida. And that's just a major tragedy to her and to her family. And so she's going through the grieving process. Keep them in your prayers. Amen? Amen? Glory to God. Well, we want to welcome you to Chestnut Assembly, where we experience the Spirit, we embrace the lost, and where we live the life. This is a place where we honor, where we love, and we honor, and we are positive, positivity, which means we speak life to each other. We don't tear each other down, but we lift each other up. And I thank God that this is a place where no perfect people are allowed. No perfect people are allowed, but because God loves us so much, He doesn't leave us where He found us. Amen? I just wonder if there are any first-time guests in the house today. This is your first time here, or this is your first time back after a long time. If that's you, just go ahead and lift your hand. We've got something that we want you to fill out. We're not going to embarrass you. Are there any first-time guests in the house? We just want to go ahead and honor you this morning. We have a hand up over here to my left. Come on, church, give them a good hand. Welcome to Chestnut Assembly of God. Thank you for being with us. Keep your hand up. Thank you. Keep your hand up. Glory to God. I'd love the honor of meeting you after the service. Praise the Lord. Lakeisha, I'm going to ask you to come and take the morning tithes and offering. Hallelujah. Come on, are you ready to give? Who's excited about giving this morning? I love to give to the Lord. I love giving to God.
Church. Bless you. Amen. I'm always excited to be in the house of God. Amen. Amen. As we prepare to take our tithes and offering, in Luke 12:34, it says, "For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also." Amen. A lot of times giving of our time, of our money, our resources can be a hard thing to do. But as believers, is a way to reflect God's love. It's a way for us to live out of our purpose of servanthood. It's part of our worship unto Him, amen? He is the perfect example of a giving heart. So today I encourage you to trust Him not just with the little things, but with the big things. Trust him with all of it and watch how he'll move in your life. Amen. So I'm going to have the ushers come forward. Amen. And we're going to pray and prepare to give our tithes and our offerings. Amen. Father God, we just thank you. We thank you, Lord, for being a perfect example for us. We ask, Father God, as we prepare to give, that you open our hearts, Father. We know that it's a hard thing, and we just ask that you work in that area. Father God, I ask, Father God, that you bless each and every one of us, that you bless this house, Father God, that you continue to provide for everyone, that you continue to provide for this house. We place it all in your hands, Lord. We trust in you. In your holy, precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. You can come forward. If you're not giving here today, there's multiple ways to give. You can give through text. You can text Chestnut to 73256. You can use Cash App at $ChestnutAG. You can use our Realm app if you have it. You can now also give through PayPal at ChestnutAG. Our website at chestnutassemblyofgod.org, and you can also mail it or drop it in at 2554 East Chestnut Avenue.
Come on, let joy be your portion today. Come on, let joy be your portion today. Glory to God. Glory to God. You may be seated. Come on, some of you got the spirit of Eeyore on you. You need the spirit of joy on you. Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Just a couple of announcements before we change the order of service. If you are a high school graduate, please see Rich and Lakeisha. We want the honor of taking you to lunch and celebrating this milestone in your life. We want to remind you that we have Freedom Encounter next Saturday. We have 14 people that went through our Freedom curriculum that are getting ready to be totally wrecked by God next Saturday. And we're just totally excited about that. We want to remind you about our progressive dinner that's coming up. If you have any questions about the progressive dinner or you want to be a part of that, please see Marilyn Snook after the service at Guest Services. we want to, July 4th this year is on a Sunday. Did you know that? Well, I'm telling you now, July 4th is, and some of you immediately went, I'm going to the beach, I'm not going to church. Shame, shame, shame. I'm not trying to put a curse on you, but shame, shame, shame. Listen, we're going to do a special thing on July 4th here. We're going to have an outside service under the tent. We're going to ask you to bring your chair. There's going to be worship. We're going to have food afterwards. There's going to be games. We're going to have a water baptism service on July 4th, that morning service. So if you have never been baptized in water, if you have never been baptized in water, you need to sign up. We have a sign-up sheet at guest services. We want you to sign up, and we are going to dunk you in water and keep you there depending on how bad you were. Right, George? Right, Brother George? That's right. So I'm so excited about July 4th. Don't stay home and don't go to the beach. Come into the house of the Lord on July 4th. Amen. Last week was our Mission Sunday. Thank you, thank you, thank you, thank you to everyone who has made a commitment to give in missions. We have not met our budget yet. You still have an opportunity to give over at our missions table. If you weren't here last week, you can make a faith promise for general missions. And then we have our school. We have our school in Haiti, the school on the hill. And we still have about 30 kids that need to be adopted. We need 30 kids to be adopted. $1 a day, $31 a month, and we would love for you to help us do that. It'll be a real blessing to them and a real blessing to you. Also, this is amazing. We've got one of our small groups who felt that God was leading them to build a well. That's so exciting. That's so exciting. See, that doesn't excite you as much because you can go to Wawa and buy a $2 bottle of water. Or you can go to your house and turn on the tap and drink water. That doesn't excite you. But I understand because during COVID, I wanted chicken. I couldn't find chicken. So in some of these countries and in Haiti, there's a real lack of water. And we need wells built. And what a way to bless that community. And so Tony Lugo's group, they're collecting money to build a well in Haiti on behalf of this church. The well only costs only $1,500. That's it. That's not a lot of money. So if you're interested in giving, Tony, raise your hand so we can see your beautiful face. There he is back there. He's one of our ushers. See Tony after the service. And I know that we will be a great blessing. We want to remind you, there is no men's ministry this week because of the memorial service for Joe. Also, believe it or not, we are getting ready for Vacation Bible School. We haven't had Vacation Bible School in 2 years because of COVID, but we are going to do Vacation Bible School this year. It is the end of July, Monday through Friday. I believe that's July 26th through the 30th. It's going to be from 6 to 8, and we are doing a mega sports camp. It's going to be outside. Man, you didn't get excited about that. I felt like you were. Anyway, it's just going to be amazing for the community. It's going to be amazing for the kids. We've got an array of sports. We're going to have people teaching. They're going to be playing. And they're going to get here. The most important part is they're going to get a presentation of the gospel in a way that they can understand. And so this is for children from kindergarten to fifth grade. Kindergarten to fifth grade. And we need your help. We need volunteers, men and women alike. And so please see Angel and Nicole de Jesus out in the foyer. Ricky, do you have that video of the fire? I want to show you this video. We have volume? No, that's not it. All right, what are we watching here? I want to tell you what we're watching. I got the devastating news this week that our pastor in Haiti, Pastor Pierre Joseph, his house burned down. This is his house. This was during the fire. Very devastating. Thank God, by the grace of God, he is safe, his wife is safe, and his four children are safe. No one was injured at all during this fire. Here's the amazing thing, what he tells me. He said, Pastor Tony, he said, we were getting ready to launch a 40-day praying and fasting. The enemy's not happy. In a culture that is filled with voodoo, for 40 days and 40 nights, there was going to be praying and fasting in our church there in Haiti. Okay, you can stop the video, Ricky. Thank you. Now, here's the thing. And this is amazing. It will only cost $3,000 to build his home. That's it. $3,000 to build his home. And I know some of you are probably saying, oh, you're always asking for money. I'm telling you, do what the Lord asks you to do. Not everybody can do everything. I get that. But I want to always present the needs. That's important for me to do that as your pastor, to present the needs that are represented. And I think that we can bless this man of God and have the $3,000 so that he can rebuild his home. To let him know that there's a church in Vineland, New Jersey that loves him, loves his children, and loves what he's doing there on behalf of the Lord, but on behalf of this house. I'm not going to take an offering now. What we're going to do, as you leave, there is a basket on our missions table. If you want to contribute toward the rebuilding of Pastor Pierre's house, put it in the basket, and I know that you will be blessed, and they definitely will be blessed. Amen? Praise the Lord. I think that's everything here. We're going to dismiss our children. Did somebody get excited because I was done with the announcements? See, they got more excited about that than about giving to Pierre's house. Is there a problem with that? I don't know. I have a problem with that. Pastor Tony's done. Thank God. Whatever. Anyway, we're going to dismiss our children right now, age kindergarten to fifth grade. We're going to dismiss them with Angel and Nicole. Go ahead, parents. If you're taking, please take your child back there so you can register your child. Also, we're dismissing the Aurora Rangers. We're also dismissing our teenagers today and our middlers today to go back with Lakeisha. So God bless you all, you guys, as you minister to our children. And I'm going to ask the rest of you, come on, stand to your feet. Stand to your feet with joy. With joy. Come on, with joy. And go meet some people around you. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to ask you to find your seats, please, this morning. Glory to God. Hallelujah. If you notice, we have started the process of moving our sound system to the main floor, back down on the first floor. We are just committed to making sure that we have the most excellent sound that we can have. And so just know that we're working on that. We're doing the best that we can do, and we're working. And I just absolutely appreciate our tech team and the lighting team, the computer team, and everyone involved in that. It's just, you have no idea. And the people that came out yesterday to help this process, from removing the pews to looking at all the wires and all, you have no idea the amount of work it takes to do something like this. So everyone who was involved in that, thank you. Thank you so much. Praise the Lord. Well, come on, are you happy to be in the house of the Lord today? Glory to God. You know, a couple weeks ago, I started talking to us about our mission in the house and what our mission is. And I want you to hang in there with me for the next few moments, 30, 40 minutes or so, as we talk about experiencing the Spirit, embracing the lost, and living the life. You've heard me declare these things every day, every Sunday, for 2 years. You should be able to say them without even looking at the screen. Are you ready? Experience the Spirit, embrace, and, okay, three of you. One more time. Experience, embrace, and we're getting better. How about one more time? Go. Experience. That's what I'm talking about. That's it. But I started to talk to you a couple weeks ago. Then we had a couple guest speakers. And so I want to continue today, because it's real important that we know at Chestnut Assembly of God what our identity is. We have to know what our God-given mandate and call is in this house. How many of you know that it's important to know what we stand for here at Chestnut Assembly of God? And knowing what we stand for as a church and knowing what God has called us to keeps us focused. It helps us to make decisions, because if it doesn't line up with where God is leading us, then the answer is no to that thing. Amen? You hear me? Okay. So several weeks ago, I started to talk to you about the mission, the first part of the mission, which is experiencing the Spirit. And I want you to know, I just want to go through that very quickly. I want you to know that this house is a Spirit-led, Spirit-focused, Spirit-empowered, and Spirit-led church and ministry. We love the Spirit of the living God in this house. And I want the congregation to know that Holy Spirit has full reign in this house. Full reign in our services. He knows what we need. He knows what's best. He knows who's going to be here. He knows what they need to hear. He's giving me direction. We keep our ear in tune to him. It's not an it. Holy Spirit is not an it. He's a person. He's a third person of the Trinity. Holy Spirit is a him. And so we listen. We listen. We listen. We listen to the Holy Spirit as he leads us in everything that we do, because we know that the Holy Spirit will lead us into all truth. Amen? Listen to these powerful words from Jesus, found in John 5 and 19. And he said this. Jesus explained, "I tell you the truth." Now this is so interesting to me. "I tell you the truth. The Son can do nothing by himself. The Son can do nothing by himself. He does only what he sees the Father doing. Whatever the Father does, the Son also does." And I want you to know that here at Chestnut Assembly of God, we strive to be wholly led by the Holy Spirit. Whatever he tells us to do, we want to do. Whatever he shows us to do, we are to do. Whatever he tells us to say, we are to say as we stay in tune with his voice. We can do nothing in this house without the leading of the Holy Spirit. Nothing. And we must hear from the Holy Spirit, and we must get his direction so that we can experience the Spirit of God. so that we can have a spirit-empowered service and live a spirit-empowered life. Because how many of you know that the Holy Spirit doesn't only speak to us in church? He speaks to you in your car. He speaks to you when you're getting ready to yell at your wife. I've messed up that one quite a bit. But he speaks to you every day if you would just tune yourself to the Holy Spirit. Somebody say amen. We must be led. We must be led by the Spirit of God as we come into this house with full expectancy, full anticipation, so that we can meet with him and walk in the power that he has for us. If we try to have church in our own power and in our own strength, that's not much of a church. That's not a church that I want to be a part of. Our carnal efforts are weak. They're weak. They're temporary. And they're empty at best. And I don't know about you, but I don't want to be in a church that's full of a bunch of religious dictates and mandates, bunch of religious traditions that we have to do a certain thing. I want to be a church that's led by the Holy Spirit of God. What we want and what we need. Church, this is what we need. That every time we get together, listen to me, every time we get together, Sunday mornings, and every small group that we have, every youth group, every young adults, every children's ministry time, every freedom group, every fellow, everything that we do, that the Holy Spirit is invited into that place so that we can experience his Spirit. Must be Spirit-led. In everything we do, we must experience the Spirit. How many of you would say, Pastor, I need the Holy Spirit. I'm in great need of the Holy Spirit. Come on, make a little noise if you need the Holy Spirit today. Make a little noise if you need the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And that's experiencing the Spirit. But today I want to focus in on embracing the lost. Turn to your neighbor and say, embracing the lost. Embracing the lost. I want you to know that I have a deep place in my heart for the lost. You want to know why? Because I was lost. I was lost. Do you remember when you were lost? Do you remember what it felt like when you were lost? I wasn't necessarily what you would consider a bad person. You know, I wasn't a murderer, not a molester, none of those horrible, not a drug dealer. I wasn't a prostitute. Hello. Come on. But let me tell you what, my heart was far away from God. And if I would have died in that sinful condition where my heart was far away from God, I would have split hell right in half if I would have died. So some of you need to adjust your halos when you think about your past. And some of you are saying, like, please, Pastor, don't make me think about my past. Please don't take me back there, because it was a horrible place. The things that I did, the things that I said. Oh God, Pastor, I'm so ashamed. Well, you don't need to be ashamed, because God brought you from that. And it's important for us to remember. We need to remember where we came from. We need to know what God set us free from, what he brought us from, where he saved us from, how he saved me, how he healed me, how he filled me with the Holy Spirit, how he set me free, how he broke the shackles in my life. Come on. So that we are able to relate to the lost. So that we're able to relate to other people that are lost. You remember how he reached his arm, his long, powerful arm into your miry clay? Do you remember the mess that you were in? The filth that you were in? How you were jacked up and messed up? I remember, and I never want to forget. Because here's the thing, the sad thing was, I was lost. I didn't know I was lost. I didn't know that I was lost. And there are lost people everywhere, don't you know? There are lost people everywhere. They're in your families. They're at your work. Some of them are your enemies. And some of you are saying, let them stay lost. No, no, no. Because you walk around with the answer to eternal life. You do. You do. You do. walk with the answer. You have the answer so that they won't split hell right in half. And the thing that I want you to know about Chestnut Assembly, one of the things that we need to understand about this house, and if you're a part of this house, one of the things that you need to understand is that we want the lost to know that they are welcome in this house. They are welcome in this house. I'm not concerned about what other churches are doing or what other ministries are doing with the lost. I just know that in this house, we must be intentional about embracing the lost. That is a part of our DNA. That is a part of our culture. And if we want a church that Jesus is attracted to, then we will embrace the lost. Because Jesus is attracted to lost people. Did you know that? Luke 19 and 10, look what it says. For the Son of Man, that's Jesus, came to seek and save those who are lost. Part of Jesus' mandate was to not just to save the lost, but he went intentionally looking for them. He went seeking for them. And I don't know about you, but when I was lost, I was minding my own business. I didn't ask Jesus to come into my life or to introduce himself to me and my wife. But all of a sudden, I didn't invite him, but he busted down the doors of my life, and he found me. I didn't find him. And I say, praise God that he found me and what he's done, and praise God that he's found you. And we have a mandate in this house. Listen, church, we have a mandate in this house to seek and save those that are lost. We have a mandate to embrace the lost, to introduce them to Jesus. We have a mandate to go after the lost intentionally. Everywhere you go, everywhere you look, there are lost people. Don't get confused because they look good and smell good and can talk good. Okay? They need Jesus. I don't care if they're a millionaire or I don't care if they're a hobo in the street. They need Jesus. There's an incredible account in the book of Luke chapter 14, and it talks about a man who was getting ready to put on this great supper, and he had invited a ton of people to this party. It was going to be an incredible thing, and so it was ready. It was time for the supper. It was time for the party, and what he did, he sent out all of his servants to go out and bring back the ones that he had invited. Invitations were sent. There was a guest list. And as the servants went to each guest to tell them, the supper is ready, the party is ready, come to my master's house, they each began to make excuses. Excuses about why they could not come to the supper. The first one said, I bought a piece of property and I've got to go check it out. The other one said, hey, I bought some oxen and some farm animals and I've got to go test them out. Please excuse me. The other one said, I just got married. Please excuse me. Yeah. The servant went back to the master. The servants went back to their master and told the master, excuses, excuses, excuses. Those whom you have invited don't want to come. And the master said to the servants, he said, go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city and bring in here the poor, bring in here the maimed, the lame, and the blind. And then the master said in verse 23, he said, go out into the highways, go out into the byways, the hedges, and compel them, say compel, compel them to come into my house so that my house may be filled. Chestnut Assembly of God, I want you to know that I'm not satisfied and won't be satisfied until this house is filled. God has a desire that this house would be filled. I want this house filled with all kinds of people. People that are transparent and that are hungry for God. People that come into the house that are ready to pursue God. That they come with anticipation to press into God. Not to sit in a pew for 40 years and take up a spot and complain and get fat and get obese with the spirit, with the word of God. But people that are ready to come and put their hands to the plow and to push and to dig and to seek and to press. That's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for people that are Jesus lovers. Where are my Jesus lovers in the house? Where are the Jesus lovers? See, I'm not going to worry about people who don't want to come into the house. I'm not going to go after those that keep making excuses, excuse after excuse. You know who I'm talking about, because you deal with them too. But I will work with the people that God sends into this house, every single one. I will focus on those people that make the house of the Lord a priority in their life, because it's a biblical mandate to come into the house of the Lord. Sometimes we only want to invite people that look good or that are easy to talk to. They're our friends. We know them. You know, they're clean. They're well-spoken. You know, good people, relatively good people. And there's nothing wrong with that, because they need Jesus too, don't they? Many of them don't even know that they need Jesus. Things have gone so well for them in their lives that they think because they've got it all together, they don't need Jesus. They're pretty much self-sufficient. You know what I'm talking about. You know, people that don't have any room in their life for Jesus, because, you know, they got the houses and the cars and the women and the men and all. Just things are going good. There's not enough room in their life. And that's okay, because we'll keep inviting them. But guess who else needs Jesus? The drug dealer needs Jesus. The prostitute needs Jesus. The unwed mother needs Jesus. The drug addicted teenager needs Jesus. The LGBTQ population, they need Jesus. The alcoholic needs Jesus. The gender confused people need Jesus. The homeless man on the street needs Jesus. The man or the woman having an adulterous affair needs Jesus. The young couple, the old couple that's living together without being married, they need Jesus. That was me and my wife. We were living together for 3.5 years before we were introduced to Jesus, before he budded in our lives. They need Jesus. We need Jesus. And the church, according to the scriptures, we are compelled to go out everywhere in our day-to-day lives and invite the lost to come into this house, because this house is a treasure in the hands of the Lord. Not because of me, not because of you, because the Holy Spirit leads this house and he knows what they need. And every Sunday, we serve a full course meal for people to eat, for people to drink, to take in of the goodness of the Lord, see and taste that the Lord is good. Invite the lost into the house so that they can also eat with us. Somebody say amen and amen. We have the account in Luke 15. It's the parable of the lost sheep. We all know it, or most of us know it. I'm just going to read a portion of it. It says that tax collectors and other notorious sinners often came to listen to Jesus teach. And this made the Pharisees and the teachers of religious law complain that he was associating with such sinful people, and he was eating with them. Wow. So Jesus told them the story. He said, if a man has 100 sheep and one of them gets lost, what will he do? Won't he leave the 99 others in the wilderness and go to search for the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he will joyfully carry it home on his shoulders. When he arrives, he will call together his friends and his neighbors and rejoice with me because I have found my sheep. And in the same way, listen to this, in the same way, there is more joy in heaven over one lost sinner who repents and returns to God than over 99 who are righteous and have not strayed away. See, sinners were attracted to Jesus and his teachings. I wonder how many sinners are attracted to us. Jesus had a bad habit of hanging out with bad people. When's the last time you hung around like a bad person? Intentionally. Or do we just do that holy huddle where we just hang around other believers because we don't want to be contaminated? Should be the other way. We can contaminate them. You didn't get that. You can contaminate them. There's something, there was something about Jesus in that day that the lost, the vile, the sick, they were attracted to Jesus. They wanted to be around him. They wanted to hang out with him. They wanted to talk to him. Even the notorious sinners, you know what that means? That they were well known publicly for their sin. It wasn't like us. We hide our sin. We know how to hide. Bless the Lord. Bunch of liars. But they were notorious. They were known for their sin, and they wanted to hang out with Jesus. There was something about that. But because of this, the Pharisees and the teachers of the religious law complained about how Jesus associated with such people. And they even complained, can you imagine, that he ate with them. I mean, you want to make the religious spirit mad? Hang out with some bad people. You want to make the religious spirit mad? Go out and reach the lost. Bring them into the house of the Lord. I remember the story of this church and this, there was an older gentleman, probably in his 80s, who was known to be very judgmental and critical about teenagers coming in, but God really spoke and dealt with his heart. And this one Sunday morning service, this young man comes in, blue hair, broken up jeans, no shoes, all tatted up, piercings, didn't smell real good. And he walked in late, walked right down the center aisle, and sat right on the ground, on the floor. And everybody got nervous, and they looked at the old guy. The old guy got up from the back, and they were all afraid what he was going to do to this kid. And the old man came down slowly and plopped himself right next to that young man and put his arm around him and said, young man, you are welcome in this house. How many of you know that in churches, everywhere you go, but in churches, you always have people that are going to complain about something. There's always people that will criticize everything you do, everything that you say. They have the spirit of having an opinion all the time. It's the spirit of irritation. And I want to give them the spirit of laying my hands on them. Glory to God. And listen, let me tell you something. I love you, and I know most of you love me. And I know we're doing good things, and God is using us mightily. But let me tell you something. I'm not here to please you. I'm not here to please you. I'm here to please God. And he has mandated this house to embrace the lost and to accept everyone that comes into this house. And I've come to please God, and I know you have too. And reaching lost people pleases God. It's not just my four and no more. It's reaching the lost people. All kinds of people. All kinds of people. And if Jesus did it, then I want to do it. If Jesus said it, then I want to say it. I've had lunches. I've gone out to lunch with transgenders. And I get that evil eye from people that walk by that know me. You know, because I want to get to know people. Everyone's got a story. Don't you know that? That's why I lived on the streets for 3 days several years ago with the homeless, because I wanted to know what it was like. Not to get a pat on the back. Lord knows it was the scariest thing of my life. But I wanted to know what it was like. Once the sheep was found, once the shepherd found the sheep, we don't know how long it took. But it didn't matter. The scripture says that the shepherd, this is so amazing to me, the shepherd would joyfully, after he found the sheep, he would pick up the sheep, put it on his neck, and he would carry that sheep all the way home like this. Such joy. Such joy. All the way home. He didn't care about the pain on his back. He didn't care about how much time it took, the discomfort, even the smell of the animal. His total concern was for the well-being of the sheep. You know where I'm going in this? Do you understand where I'm going in this? He didn't yell at the sheep and say, "You stupid sheep, you got lost." He didn't punish the sheep. He didn't make the sheep walk. He carried the sheep all the way home because finding the sheep was worth it all to him. Finding the lost is worth it to Jesus. And finding the lost is important to this house. And the shepherd would return back and he would introduce the sheep back to the 99. And they would all rejoice. The friends would rejoice. And there was sincere, authentic, rejoicing reconciliation. Reunited, and it feels so good. Reunited, cause. Da 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 da. Come on, baby, right there. That's what I'm talking about. See, y'all were lost ones too. That's it. Glory. A bunch of carnal Christians, but I love it. I love you. And the end of that scripture verse, the end of that scripture verse is so powerful to me. It says, in the same way, there is more joy in heaven over one lost sinner who repents and returns to God than over 99 that have already righteous and have not strayed away. And this is one of the greatest miracles that we experience in this house for years on a regular basis, that people come into this house and the Holy Spirit ministers to the lost and they say yes to Jesus. That's why when somebody raises their hand to accept Jesus, that's why we rejoice with them. We rejoice with them because all of heaven is rejoicing as they give their lives to Jesus. And we have in verse 8, we have the parable of the lost coin, where the woman had 10 coins. She lost one. She would light up a lamp and sweep the entire house. She will search carefully until she finds it. And when she finds it, she will call all of her friends and all of her neighbors and say, "Rejoice with me because I have found my lost coin." And I love this. In the same way, there is joy in the presence of God's angels when even one sinner repents. See, it's the same way with this woman. She didn't care that it was late. She didn't care that it was dark. She didn't care how much work she was going to have to do. Right away, she turned on the lamp and she started to search and sweep throughout her whole house. She could have been satisfied with 9. She had 10. She lost one. She could have been satisfied with 9. She wasn't satisfied. Let us not be satisfied. Let us not be satisfied. Amen. The end of that portion of scripture, I just love. It says, there is joy in the presence of God's angels when even one sinner repents. See, by faith, you've got to understand, when people come to this altar and give their lives to Jesus, there is a Holy Ghost party that occurs in heaven. A Holy Ghost party that occurs in heaven. And that's why when people give their lives to the Lord in this house, we rejoice with them. We will in this house embrace the lost. And this house is where everyone, and I mean everyone, is welcomed. And I know when I say that, some of you cringe. Because I know, and you know, lost people can be messy. Lost people can be difficult. Remember when you got saved? You were messy. And you were difficult. And 30 years later, some of you are still messy. And still difficult. Come on, somebody. Don't look around. Don't point to anybody. But how many of you are grateful to be a part of a church that welcomes everyone? That everyone is welcome in this house? I don't want to be a part of a church that doesn't know how to embrace the lost. That would become a religious club, some sort of social club. That's not what I'm here for. God has given us a mandate. That's why our guest services is so critical. Front lines ministry to the lost as they walk through this door. You know, they're happy, they're upbeat, they're fun. The cafe has to be fun. The front desk has to be fun. The guest services and just upbeat and full of joy of the Lord. Not the spirit of Eeyore. Well, okay. I guess you can come in. There's nothing attractive to that at all. One of the greatest weapons that we have in this church, one of the greatest weapons, is not Bible-thumping theology. It's not our denominational affiliation. It's not that we speak in tongues or that we prophesy. It's not that we have amazing worship. It's not that we feed the homeless. It's not that we have small groups and all the ministries to our people. It's not that we have a beautiful building that God has given to us. And it's not even our man-made traditions. But the greatest weapon that we have in this house is the ability to love and accept the lost without condemnation and without judgment as they walk through our doors. Now the three of these remain: faith, hope, and love. But the greatest is love. I don't want anyone in this house to ever feel judged or condemned when they come through our doors. That's not our job. Too many of us want to play Holy Ghost Junior and convict people and judge people. And the last thing a person needs is to be condemned or judged as they walk through our doors. Especially, and you know this to be true, do you know how difficult it is sometimes for an unbeliever to get up on a Sunday morning, get dressed, hopefully take a shower, but they don't have to, do their hair, put on their weave, put on their nails, put on their toupee, get dressed, and come to church? The last thing they need is to walk through the doors of this house and be judged because of the way they dress or because of the way they look. If I ever hear anyone judging or condemning any one of our guests that come through our front doors, I will crucify you to the cross myself. We'll put you outside on our gold cross. We'll make an example of you to all of Vineland. Hallelujah. Where did that come from? Jesus. It's not in my notes. I'm looking. I was like, where did that come from? Holy Ghost? I'm just not interested in a church that makes people feel horrible about themselves. People already feel horrible about themselves, don't you know? I want a church where life is being spoken. And what Vineland needs is a church like Chestnut Assembly of God that has her doors open to everyone, overwhelmed and overcome by the love of God. Amen? Psalm 40 and verses 2 through 3 says this, that he brought me up out of a horrible pit. He brought me up out of a miry clay, and he set my feet on a rock, and he established my steps, and he has put a new song in my mouth. Praise to God, that many will see it and fear and will trust in the Lord. We were all there. We were all there. We were all in the miry pit. We were all messed up, jacked up, and we're all in our process. Pastor Barb talked about process. We are all in our process. And if you know today, beyond the shadow of a doubt, that you would not be here without the love and grace and mercy of the Lord, I want you to make a little noise in this house today and give him some praise for what he's done. He's been good to you. He's been good to me. He's been good to me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want you to know that Jesus didn't die for us because we've got it all together. He didn't die because of what I could do for him, offer him. He simply died because he loved me. He simply died because he loved you in your wretched, rebellious condition. We embrace the lost in this house. We must demonstrate what's called agape love. Say agape. Agape. Agape love. What is agape love? It's selfless. It's unconditional. It's a love that's sacrificial. It's God's divine love. It's a love that loves the unworthy. It's a love that loves the undeserving. Because how many of you know it's easy to love the lovable? But we truly have not loved until we love the unlovable. See, agape love loves you when you ain't got it going on. See, agape love loves you when you're struggling, when you're hurting, when you're still making mistakes, and when you're ugly. Well, not ugly, acting ugly. The truth is that, and here's the truth, none of us would be here without Jesus' agape love. None of us. And the one thing that stops devils in their tracks, and the one thing that tears down the power of evil and devastates hell and paralyzes the power of darkness is when agape love is expressed and shown from a pure heart. See, it's agape love when we demonstrate that to each other and especially the lost. That's when we know the church is operating correctly. That's when we know we're doing the right thing, because agape love is patient. It's patient with people. Agape love suffers a long, 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 long time. That's what agape love does. The truth is, here's the truth. We can sit here and try to be cute and not remember where we came from. But you wouldn't be here if it wasn't for God's long suffering with you and with me. Come on, say amen. Amen. You know that's true. And as your pastor, I'm committed toward moving this house in a greater level of agape love. It's agape love. And I declare and decree that Chestnut Assembly of God will have and express agape love as we embrace the loss. We will have agape love as we deal with one another, a long-suffering love. And the truth is, we will never know what love is until you love someone who's not lovable. Then you'll know what true love is. And that means loving people who come through our doors, and even though they may not be transformed and changed as quickly as you think they need to be changed. I remember having a conversation with someone, and they said to me, I think that people should be changed within 90 days of salvation. 90 days. I'm disqualified. I've been doing this thing 30 years, and I'm still in my process. How about you? Is there anybody perfect in this house? Okay, I want to see who the liar is, who needs to be delivered from the spirit of lying. No perfect people. George is close, but he's not perfect. If you're perfect, we want you to stand in the foyer so we can touch you on the way out. That's why we're continuing to work on our VIP ministries. Church, I haven't forgotten VIP ministries. You've blessed this house with buses. I'm looking for people that would want to lead my VIP ministry. What is VIP ministry? When we go out into the streets, the highways, the byways, and we compel anyone who wants to come into this house. And we will pick them up. We'll go to the homeless shelter. We'll go to the domestic violence. We'll go wherever we need to go to pick up people who want to come into this house. We'll bring them in. We'll give them a meal. We'll minister to them. We'll love on them. They'll be a part of this house, and then we'll take them back home. If there's anybody in this house that thinks they would want to lead that kind of a ministry, please, please see me after the service. See, it's easy to love people that look like you, act like you, talk like you, and even worship like you. It's easy to love people that dress like you or believe like you. But true agape love says, I will love you even though you're different. I will love you even though you don't think the way I do. I will love you even though you don't look the same way that I do. Because you're in your process and I'm still in mine. We're at two different places in our process. And just because we know how to hide our sin as mature believers doesn't mean that we're better than anybody else. Because we are not. Agape love doesn't get frustrated. Agape love does not get haughty or judgmental or impatient. Doesn't look down the shaft of your nose at people because they're in different places than you are. Agape love says this: if God can do it for me, he'll do it for you. If he saved me, he'll save you. If he set me free, God will set you free. And Chestnut Assembly of God is a church where we love everyone right where they are. Right where they are. We've been praying for that. That the Lord would send people. All kinds of people. I'm looking for the millionaire, lawyer, doctor, entrepreneur. But I'm also looking for the homeless. For the prostitutes. For the ones that people forget. For the nobodies. And let me tell you, I don't care what you've come into this house with today. I don't care what you're dealing with. And I don't care what you're going to deal with. Your addiction, your depression, whatever your struggle. Because I still believe that there is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. I still believe that today. And I believe that for you. It's one encounter. One touch from the Master can change everything. And will change everything. And I've come to tell somebody today about Jesus. And to let him know that his love is greater than anything you've carried into this place. I don't care how filthy and disgusting or horrible it may be. And baby, we want you to know that we're going to love you through your process. We're going to help you through your process. Don't hide. Don't hide your struggles. Let us know. We want to help you. We want to love you. We want to encourage you. We want to help you be set free. Don't come into the house and put your mask on. Get the stinking mask off. For real. Get it off. And let's be honest with each other. You know, a fisherman doesn't clean his fish before he catches them, does he? He doesn't. How many of you know that we don't stand outside of our shower, turn the water on, and stand outside and take a washcloth or one of those spongy things, and we start washing our bodies before we go in the shower? If you do that, there's something wrong with you. And we have counseling service available for you. You're weird if you do that. But you don't do that. Do you do that? I don't. Somebody just ran out the building. Maybe it was them. He's like, the Lord exposed me. Holy Spirit tells us everything we know. You don't wash yourself before you go in the shower. You go in there as filthy as you are, and the water washes you off. And I want people to know that you don't have to clean yourself off before you come into this house. You can come in dirty, filthy, jacked up, messed up. Come as you are. You come as you are. Because say it with me, no perfect people allowed. We accept everyone here at Chestnut. All right, did you hear me? We accept everyone here at Chestnut. But what some of you are hearing me say, listen closely, you're hearing me say that we accept all the sin to come into the house. That's not what I'm saying. We are not condoning sin. Sin still must be dealt with. We accept the person, but we hate the sin. We love you, but we hate your sin. You love me, but you would hate my sin. So we're not saying that. We're not saying come in and live in your sin. We say no perfect people allowed. And thank God he doesn't leave us where he found us. He's not going to let me stay where I am. And he's not going to let you stay where you are. Because why? Because he loves us. He loves us. And he knows how to deal with our sin. He knows how to deal. He knows how to bring holy conviction into my life. And it's the goodness of the Lord that leads me to repentance. Did you hear that? The goodness of the Lord leads me to repentance. Experiencing the goodness of the Lord causes me to want to repent. Because God is so good. I don't want to displease God. So any sin that I'm involved in, I want to eradicate that thing right away. Because I want to please God. It takes every bit of strength for a new person to come into this house. It takes courage for a new person to come into this house for the first time. You're a little bit intimidating. This house is intimidating. The size of this building is intimidating. But I want you to know that God is continually drawing lost people into this house. I continually hear stories. I was driving down Chestnut, going somewhere else, and I was compelled to turn into your driveway and come to your service. He's constantly drawing people into this house. And so many of those people, and you know this, feel so unworthy. How many of you know they come into this place so heavy? Like Pastor Greg mentioned about that spirit of heaviness. They come in here heavy, beaten down, beat up by the world, beat up by some of their own choices. And they're looking to come into a place that's a refuge. A place where they can be loved and accepted. A place where they can be accepted and encouraged and helped. Now think about the prodigal son, who finally, when he came to himself, he came back home. Could you imagine how terrible he felt about himself? Even the pigs didn't want him around. The pigs got attitudes. And he left. You know, the father, when he saw him from the porch, what an incredible story, an account of the father who saw his son afar off. We don't know how long it was, but that father just prayed and prayed and prayed. And he saw his son, was looking. He said, could that be my boy? Could that be him? He looks a little skinny. He looks a little dirty. But is that my boy? And the scripture says that the father went running to the boy. Running to the boy. And he says that the scripture says that the father threw himself on his son. Threw himself. Wrapped his arms around his neck. And started kissing his son. And welcomed him home. He didn't beat him up. Didn't condemn him. He didn't tell him how horrible he was. What a horrible son. How disrespectful he was to ask for his inheritance before his father had died. He welcomed him home. He embraced the lost. And that's a picture of our Heavenly Father. Of how he accepts us. He embraces us. No condemnation. No punishment. It's time for the church to stop beating people up. I'm not saying we do that all the time. But it's time for the church in general to stop beating people up. And I expect that Chestnut Assembly of God, this house, and you, that we will be a house that we're kind. And that we're welcoming, and that we're loving, and we're gracious. Not just to each other. It's easy to love each other, but to a lost and dying world, letting them know that they belong in this house. Nobody is better than anybody in this house. Nobody. Nobody. I don't care if you came in here in a Bentley. Or if you walk barefooted. I don't care if you have a $1,000 pair of sneakers. Or you went to Goodwill and got a $5 pair of Bobos. I could care less. You're welcomed in this house. We are all equal because we have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Let the redeemed say so. Where are the redeemed people in the house? Where are the redeemed people in the house? So I don't care what your background is. I don't care if you're messed up and jacked up. I don't care what your sexual orientation is. That's right. I said it. I don't care if you're bound by homosexuality, drug abuse, alcohol abuse, sexual perversion. I don't care if you suffer from mental illness, depression, if you're crazy, if you're full of anxiety, if you're just confused. I don't care if you're black, brown, if you're tan, if you're yellow, if you're as blue as a Smurf and white as a snow. I don't care if you're a Democrat or a Republican. I don't care if you're Black Lives Matter, Blue Lives Matter, or All Lives Matter. I don't care what you've done, and I don't care what you haven't done. I don't care if you're religious and legalistic, and I don't care if you're demon-possessed and you have a legion of demons in you. I don't care. All I know is this, that there is a name above every other name on heaven and on earth and beneath the earth, that every knee shall bow and that every tongue shall confess. That's what I know. That's all I know. That's what I know. If you know it, come on, give him some praise. Hallelujah. It's that name. It's that beautiful name. It's that beautiful name. Hallelujah. It's his name that brings change. It's his name that brings transformation. It's his name that brings victory. No other name but the name of Jesus. Sing with me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound. That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy rains, unending love, amazing grace. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together. Put your hands together. Give the Lord a mighty clap offering. Glory to God. Glory to God. In this house, we will experience the Spirit, and we will embrace the lost. Never let us forget that. Next week, I'm going to bring living the life. Oh, living the life. That's so good. Living the life. I'm going to ask you to bow your heads this morning. Hallelujah. I know Pastor Barb did a call earlier today for salvation. I'm going to ask the prayer team to please come. But you just heard me mention over and over again that we love you, we embrace the loss, that there's nothing that you can carry in this house that God can't overcome, that Jesus doesn't already know. We love you, we care for you, we want to see you set free. You don't have to hide with your struggle and with your sin. You don't have to hide. Don't hide. Don't hide. That's what the enemy does. He tries to isolate you. He tries to isolate me. Expose it. And that thing will no longer have power over you. Confessing our sins to one another. Confessing our sins to one another. No judgment. This is a no judgment zone. Praise the Lord. Planet Fitness thought they had that, but we've got it. No judgment zone in this house. Glory to God. Ricky, if you can just play some soft music in the background, please. There's a couple calls. Pastor Barb already gave the call for salvation. But if you didn't pray the prayer and you still need to get saved, don't leave this house. Don't leave this house without getting saved. Don't leave this house without getting saved. My friend, tomorrow is not promised to you or to me. I'm not trying to scare you, but that's the truth. We just don't know. But you need to be ready. We want to help you be ready. Maybe you're in a backslidden condition and you need to come back. Today is the day of salvation. We want you to come back home. We want you to come back home and rededicate your life to the Lord. And then, of course, if you're already saved but you're struggling in an area, it's okay. We all struggle. We all struggle. We all have areas. And you just want someone to help you to break that thing off of you. I'm also going to ask you to come up here if you're just struggling in an area of your life. And right now, I command every demon to let go. Every demon of fear, every distracting demon, every demon that's speaking into your ear saying, don't go up there, don't go up there, don't go up there. I just break the power of those demons right now in the mighty name of Jesus. You have no authority in this place. And we release freedom, freedom, freedom. There's a breaker anointing in this house. There's a chain-breaking anointing in this house. And so let's all stand together in the house of the Lord. And if that's you, as you're standing, just make your way out. Come on, quickly. Don't mess around. Just come quickly if you need prayer in any area of your life. Any area of your life. We want the honor of praying with you and helping you. Truly, it was good to be in the house of the Lord today. Amen. God is good. Thank you so much for being here. You are such a blessing to me and to this house. Thank you for your generosity. I'm also going to ask to remind you about our missions table. We have children that need to be adopted. We want to raise money for Pastor Pierre in Haiti to rebuild his house. All he needs is $3,000 to rebuild his home. I love you. God bless you. You are dismissed. If you need to come for prayer, come. Come down. These prayer partners will stay here for a few minutes.